Good morning, RSA. I don't know about you, but I am super excited to be here. Last year was the first year that I spoke, and I was disappointed when it was virtual. So I'm excited to be here in front of you speaking today. And thank you for sitting in on this session. Today we're going to talk about privacy. So how many of you have a privacy role at your company? Oh, yay, lots of you. That's usually not the response that I get, so that's super exciting. So just a little bit, you've seen the disclaimer. Little bit about me, I am very heavy into privacy, very active in the community. Currently, I'm a director at Hudl. We're a sports media company. I've been there about 5 or 6 weeks now. And my role is director of governance, risk, compliance, and privacy, and then a whole bunch of more stuff that, you know, there's always the as is. But I do a lot of stuff with ISACA. I do a lot of stuff with WSIS, RSA, NIST. So if you've seen me around before, I'm not surprised. I'm very active in the security and privacy realm. So if you're not connected with me on LinkedIn, feel free to connect with me. Any students out there today? None. Well, today's College Day, if you didn't know that. So this is part of the College Day track. I actually just graduated from Dakota State University with my PhD. So I am now Dr. Lisa McKee. So my PhD was in cybersecurity and data privacy. And so we saw most of you are privacy professionals. How many of you are security? Just a few? Oh, you're okay. So who does both? Okay, that's me. I'm like, yeah, I do everything. And that's probably the typical answer. They're like, well, what do? And you're like, everything. Security, privacy, vendor management, like, what do you not check the box for? So this is probably what your day feels like. CCPA, GDPR, you got all these things coming at you, and new things constantly coming, and it's like, ah, how do I manage it all, right? You feel like you're swimming amongst the sharks, and as you tell people these new laws and regs are coming, they don't always want to hear it. Our job as security and privacy people is very challenging, because we're usually the ones that have to deliver bad news, and they don't always want to hear that what they're doing isn't right, or that they have to change. That's not our fault, right? We're just the messenger. It's like, don't shoot the messenger. So oftentimes, this is what our job feels like. So to set the foundation, talking about privacy, it's understanding what data you have and what is in scope for privacy. So the definition of privacy has changed quite a bit over the last 20 years. I've been in security and privacy field for about 20 years, started off as a developer. When I first started as a developer 20 years ago, it was like 20 things, 25 data elements. Your name, your address, social security number, passport, right? There was about 25 common data elements that we would say that's PII. Now, it's anything that can relate back to a living individual. Your online profiles, your shopping carts, your education data, HR data, medical data, anything that can come back to you as an individual. And oftentimes, organizations and developers don't know that, or they don't realize the scope of personal data has changed and it is very broad. It even includes things such as your geolocation and your IP address. And developers go, well, we collect all this information, but it's not PII. And then as soon as you hear those things, you're like, ah, but yes, it is. So whenever you get an opportunity, educate your development teams, your business teams, that the definition is much more broad now than what it used to be. And the reason why that's important is because there's many privacy rights, depending on which law and regulation you look at. But there's really four core ones that are common across any privacy law and reg. That's your right to access. You have the right to go to an organization and say, what data do you have on me? You have the right to say, I want to know. Either you're an employee, you're a customer, you have that right under GDPR, many international laws, CCPA, several of the US laws that have now passed. Unfortunately, where I live, we don't have those yet, but we're working on it. Disclosure. How many are annoyed by those pop-up boxes at the bottom of every page that says click here, accept the cookies, and all we know is that that's a GDPR thing, right? Well, the reason why that's there is because they have to disclose, organizations have to tell you what data they're collecting and why. What are they going to do with that data? Who is that data shared with? So I highly, highly encourage you, don't just check that box. Read it. Are you okay with that? This is the second conference where I've spoken at this year, and I had to provide vaccine status. And the last conference I spoke at was WESIS back in March, and their policy was they were gonna share my information with all sorts of people, and they were gonna text me about my results, and I'm like, I'm just going to speak at this conference. I just wanna give you my vaccine stuff. Like, I'm not okay with all these other things, but it was an all or nothing. And I actually reached out to the organizer of that conference and said, is there another way to validate my information? Because I'm not okay with this privacy policy. And I shared that with them. So when you see that, speak up. Tell people, I'm not okay with this. And you should have that right to do that. They have to tell you what they're doing, and that doesn't mean you have to be okay with it. And find another way to get that information that you're looking for or to meet those needs that whatever took you to that website. So that's the disclosure piece. Consent. With consent, there's a lot of different forms of consent. There's implied consent. There's explicit consent. We hear consent all the time. Did you give permission is essentially what it says. So just because they're capturing the information doesn't mean you gave them permission. And so oftentimes when you see those pop-ups and those privacy disclosures, they have all of that wrapped into one. It's here's my disclosure, you're consenting to this, and though therefore by clicking that box to proceed, you're okay with everything that they're doing, which may not be true. And some companies, especially here in the US, we don't have explicit consent, which means you have to explicitly say, yes, I'm okay with this. We have laws that are more implied consent. So if you go to a page, I often do, you don't click the box, but you continue to scroll, that's implied. You're continuing to scroll, so they're assuming that you agree with everything. And that's one of the big differences between laws here in the US and internationally. And then the right to deletion is another one. We have online profiles all over the place. Like, there really isn't much that we do nowadays that isn't online. Creating another account, another username and password, you probably got 50 of them, if not more. And then you're like, oh yeah, I forgot I still have that MySpace. I don't use that anymore. Well, go ask them, please delete my data. That's what the right to deletion is. Now, there are gonna be instances where a company's gonna come back and say, we cannot fulfill your request. So if you are in the US and you're in a state, as I live in Nebraska, that does not have privacy laws, they do have that right, the organization can say, sorry, you're not in a state that has that law. GDPR, they can't do that. And not only that, they have a certain period of time in which they have to respond. And that's really, really important. Because here in the US, all of these, especially access and deletion, the response time is 45 days. California, Virginia, Colorado, the five US privacy laws, it's 45 days. From the time you submit a request to the time they have to respond, it's 45 days. Under EU privacy law, it's 30 days. That's 15 days less. Now, if you're international, more than just, you know, US and EU, Brazil's law is 15 days. So it's vitally important that you know where data is across your organization, because if you don't know where that data is, you can't meet those time periods. You won't know what information to return on an access request, or what data to delete when someone says, delete my data. So privacy across the organization. Oftentimes, privacy is thought of as its own thing. Sometimes you have privacy technologists or technical pr- privacy people, that's what I am, privacy engineer. Oftentimes it's lawyers that are just doing contract negotiation and legal reviews, and they may not know all the technical ins and outs. Regardless of what role you are, it is extremely important that privacy teams are working across the entire organization. Because we have PII in our organizations all over the place, and in places we probably don't even know that it's there. HR data, marketing data. Most organizations have a place where people can upload resumes. That's still PII. What doesn't mean you have to be a customer. You have data for other reasons too. So it's really important that as privacy professionals or security, some companies don't have specific privacy functions, and that's okay. If you also have that role, network. Get to know your SMEs across the organization so that you can help them understand the foundation of what privacy is and how it's changed in the landscape, and then the laws and regs that apply to your organization. So I created this term CompraSec, kind of like DevSecOps, play on words. It means compliance, privacy, and security. Because we don't talk enough across an organization. Getting our compliance team, security team, privacy teams, all in the same room when we talk about solutioning, when we talk about architecting. New laws are coming, so compliance or privacy might say, hey, there's this new law, and they might, if it's privacy law, they're gonna tell privacy, and then privacy is gonna tell security, well, why don't we all just get in the same room together? Let's have these conversations together. And then when it's time to make changes in the organization to policies, procedures, architecture, it really takes all three teams and more to solve for that. It's not just the security team solving things or technology. So it's really important that we're working together and collaborating collectively across the organization. So privacy. Why care? I get that all the time. Why care? So what? Everybody has my data. It's been breached 15 times this year. I got the email. Why should I care? Because if we stay dormant and accept that as status quo, nothing will change. And it's important to us to speak up, to say, this is not okay. Just because it happened to someone else doesn't mean it's okay. And I don't want that to be my company. I don't want that to be my data. So the more that you can help convince others, and especially your executive team, just ask them the question, if you see something that's not right, how would you feel if that's your data? When I've asked people that, I really get the deer in the headlight look, like, I've never thought of that. We just go do things and solution things, but we very rarely stop and think, would I be okay if that was my information? Would I still make those same decisions? And that's what this is about, is the privacy really is the foundation of an organization. The brand, the reputation, trust, loyalty. Because when those fines and breaches happen, everything crumbles. There's many privacy standards that are out there today. So the OECD published the first one. There's 8 principles under the OECD. You've got the X9.99, which is the Accredited Standards Committee. I'm a member of the Accredited Standards Committee, and we write the ANSI standards. And so they have a standard X9.99 specifically for PIAs that was also adopted by ISO, and it's the ISO 22307 PIA standard. And then recently we've had NIST come out with their privacy framework in 2000, and ISO also came out with their framework, the 27701 framework. I'm a big proponent of it doesn't matter what you do. Pick something that best fits your organization and have a complementary privacy security framework. So ISO has security privacy that go together, NIST has privacy, security that go together. There's no right answer, and there's no one size fits all. Oftentimes, international companies tend to go the ISO route. More US companies follow NIST, but it doesn't have to be that way. The biggest thing is that you're just doing something. Start somewhere. And the reason why I show this map by the IEPP tracks our state privacy laws. And they usually put an update out about once a month, sometimes more frequently, depending on how much change there's been. This was the map, the last presentation I gave in person pre-COVID, February of 2020. And when you look at this, you can see it's not very shaded in. There's three that are red, and most of them are not really shaded in. Shaded in means that they're trying. There are different phases of trying to get privacy legislation. When you look at the map today, there's more that are shaded in. Even if they're dark shade, that means they tried and it didn't pass, but that's okay. And now we have more red ones, which means they have privacy laws that have been passed that are stringent, like CCPA, like GDPR. And a lot of organizations are not tracking this. They don't know. Connecticut was the latest one, and that one just passed probably about 6 weeks ago, roughly. Did anyone know that there was a national privacy law that was proposed again within the last week? How many knew that? A few of you. Because we're not tracking the changes in the regulatory landscape. We're not monitoring what's going on out there. And I often say privacy is like a data breach. These laws are coming. Whether you realize it or not, the privacy laws and regs will be here in the US before we know it. And I highly recommend that organizations be proactive and start working on a privacy program, policies, procedures to adapt these into your program. Because it's a lot easier to be proactive and have a program in place, make a few modifications, than go, uh-oh, that just passed. It's June. It's effective in 6 months, and that's not very much time. And then companies stress out, they panic. Oftentimes, panic leads to no action because then people are like, I don't know what to do. So just start somewhere and be ready for these and be monitoring these. And again, you'll get copies of these slides, and the link to this is at the bottom. And when you go out to the site, they also have a PDF that will take you to all the laws that have been attempted. So everything that's in the gray, you can actually go out and see which bills were passed in different states. So even if your state is up here and shaded gray, as mine is, I live in Nebraska, I can go out there and see, well, what was that law? Reach out to your legislatures. As a privacy person, I kind of feel neglected. Like, I don't get these rights. I wish I did. I've told my legislatures, I've reached out to them, but I'm one voice, I try. So the more of us that reach out and say, we need this, you know, we're stronger in numbers. So privacy assessments, what does this all have to do with privacy assessments, the topic of the talk today? So this was my PhD research project, was looking at privacy assessments. We've all heard the term PIAs and DPIAs and privacy assessments, and we're like, what are they? How do I do them? What's the difference between these? Why does it matter? If you're a global company, what this tells you is that there's 27 countries that fall under the European Union, which are in scope for GDPR. All these other ones that are on the list, there's a total of 41 on this table, also have GDPR-like privacy laws. And you're like, okay, so what does that really mean? GDPR means you have to do a privacy assessment. Specifically, they talk about PIAs, privacy impact assessments, and DPIAs, which are data protection impact assessments. So oftentimes I get asked, as a consultant, as a privacy SME, what do I do, and how do I get started, and what are the differences between these things? And what we've also seen is that an increase in legislation unfortunately, does not mean a decrease in breaches. We are overregulated, continue to see new laws and regulations up, yet the number of breaches continues to grow exponentially. So how can we as privacy and security practitioners start to change this? And that's what we're gonna talk about. And oftentimes my day feels like a dumpster fire. Can y'all relate to that? You're like, there's all these things. Where do I get started? What do I do? So I told you I just started at Hudl about 6 weeks ago. And I do governance, risk, compliance, privacy, enterprise risk management, vendor management, and on. We don't have any programs. I'm fortunate enough, I have a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity where I get to go in and build all these programs from scratch, which to some might sound very daunting. But to me, I'm like, hey, that's great. I can build it the way I want right from the ground up, hire my own team instead of going and fixing somebody else's problem. But this is oftentimes what my day feels like, because there's so much work, there's so much change, there's many things going on. Who do I work with? Who do I talk to? How do I contain the noise? And my best advice is just step back, take a deep breath, it'll be okay. There's always somebody that understands what you're going through. Have colleagues to reach out to, because oftentimes I reach out to mine and go, this new law dropped, what are you doing? Does this apply to you? Or that S4J that happened, like we're all security people also? How are you solving it? So whether it's security, compliance, your days are gonna look like this, but it gets better. So let's talk about assessments. There's many templates and processes and examples of privacy assessments. And oftentimes I'm asked, well, which one do I follow? Which is the best? And then I always have to say, well, it depends. You know, the auditor in me is like, well, what are you trying to do? Why, what's your end game? And as part of my dissertation research, which was creating this new model of how to do privacy assessments, I evaluated different models that exist today. And this was one that I found. And this is by the Sears organization. And the very first box, and you'll get these slides, I know it's really hard to read the print on the screen, it basically starts with, do you have high-risk processing? If not, you don't have to do anything. And you're like, well, that's it? What about data storage? What about sharing? What constitutes high risk? What's the definition of that? So quickly I looked at this and I'm like, it doesn't really answer the questions that people keep asking me of how do I do privacy assessments. This one is from the UK. It's the EU Information Commissioner's Office. This is a Word document that I took snippets of to put up on the screen. And it again focuses on data processing. But we do so much more with data than just processing. And what it doesn't start with is, what's my scope? How do I know what to do with this or where to start? You're like, okay, yeah, we process data. We do credit card transactions. We process data. We do COVID tests. We process data. Great, so what does that have to do with this? And that's often when I get asked, like, how do I use this? Because it's just a Word doc, very little guidance. You can see the blue headings across the top with just a couple sentences on how to use it. So it's not really helpful. Then I have people that go, okay, well, what about the NIST privacy framework? We talk a lot about NIST privacy. I sit on the privacy workforce working group for the risk assessment team. And we've been going through each one of these subcategory statements. And when you look at this to do an assessment or to manage risk, it doesn't really say where to start. The NIST privacy framework, though the very first section when you open it, is inventory and mapping. The next section is business environment. This is the third box. So if you follow it sequentially, then maybe I'll start with an inventory and it'll get me to this. But it's not necessarily developed to be sequential. It's developed to give you guidance in different areas. So when you look at this, unless you understand what some of these things mean, and again, it's very pointed, bias, contextual factors, analytics, there isn't anything up there that says, well, problematic data actions, maybe that's my high-risk data processing. And some of these terms aren't even defined by NIST, or they'll say, go look at the privacy assessment methodology, the PRAM. How many of you have heard of the PRAM, the NIST PRAM? Yeah, very few. But that's not in here. You wouldn't know to go look at that. And then there's the NIST RMF, which is the risk management framework. I get all these boxes, but it's mostly talking about your high-risk processing. There's so much more to privacy assessments than just processing, and I'll tell you why. This one here starts with privacy threshold assessment. Anyone heard that term? Couple? Most not? Yeah. So when I was going through this, and I actually did a use case with this with one of my clients, and I said, oh, there's this privacy threshold assessment. They go, I've never heard of that. Well, basically, that's the first step in this DHS model. And what it's intended to do is to say, determine if you even need to do one of these things. So we go back to that first model that says, do I have data, high-risk data, yes or no? If no, I'm out. That's basically what this is saying. But it's saying it differently. And that's part of the problem that we have today with the methodologies that are out there and the frameworks that are out there is they're all saying something different. They're using different terminology. And then organizations, they're trying their best. They really want to do these things. They have to, and they know it. But which one do I follow? And what do I do? And every regulator has their own thing. And I actually work for a company that's global. We have to adhere to many laws. Many of these apply to my company. So which format do I use? Then you go back to the dumpster fire, like, great. You kind of throw your fans up. So I keep going back to the data processing, and why is that important? So H&M is a global clothing company. They have offices, retail locations all around the world. There was one location, one office, out of all the buildings, all the offices that they have globally, one, a handful of managers. Not even all of them. So think about your company. I'm a global company. We have multiple offices. We have multiple managers in each of those offices. So this was one location, a handful of managers. We're keeping records of information that were personal. Did you go to church? Tell me about your family. Other things. This company received one of the largest fines under GDPR. For that. And if you stop and think about that, you're like, that's not processing data. They're collecting it, asked, but they didn't really do anything with it. So when you look to those other frameworks that we just talked about, then a lot of them you just start to throw out because they're not processing data. They were collecting it, asking inappropriate information. But all those other models, they're really focused on processing. And what I think the problem is that we need to look at everything. Before we do an assessment, we really should know what our inventory is. What am I gonna assess? Who am I gonna talk to? How am I gonna determine what questions to ask? Because under those other models for the DHS and NIST and the ICO, they don't start with inventories. They just say, go figure out your high-risk processing, and you're like, great, where do I go? So as part of my dissertation work and as part of working with the ANSI X9 group, or the Accredited Standards Committee, this is a new methodology that I put together. And I basically said, you know, as a privacy person that has to do this, it's too complicated. We need a simple, unified methodology that incorporates all those other things into one. That looks at more than just data processing. And so that's what I'm going to walk you through, is this new methodology. So starting with an inventory, this is my favorite one, because we know what inventories are. We don't always do them well. They're not always current and accurate, but we know what those are. Companies should have them. So if we start with an inventory of our systems, application, data, vendors, we didn't talk a lot about vendors yet. Where's my data going? We talked about the privacy rights and the disclosure. We have to disclose our vendors, but if you don't know where they are or who they are, you can't disclose that. And that's where everything starts to get connected and get messy. So if we start with our inventory and we look across the organization, all those teams that we talked about, privacy across the organization, technology, your data architects and scientists, your software teams, HR, marketing, finance, accounting, it really impacts all teams across the organization. And ask them, what are your inputs and outputs? What data do you have? Where does it go? What do you do with it? You can start to then figure out your inventory and get a good foundation, which is probably going to be more than what your IT teams have, because they're just managing technologies. You need to get down to the data layer. And that's what we're doing here. And then you can map your flows, you know where data is going, and some of you might have tools that do this, some of it might be Excel spreadsheets, Visio diagrams. There's no right or wrong answer, it's just that you're doing it. And that's the inventory piece. So once we know that, then we can get into, let's start to assess. Let's start to figure out, what do we need to do? What policies and procedures do we have in place? Where's that data going? What information do we process? Do we truly process anything? Maybe you're just a collection point and you're forwarding on. And that's okay, right? We all have different business models, different purposes. There's, again, no right or wrong answer. So that's what we're doing here, is determining what type of assessments do I need to do. Maybe you are required to adhere to GDPR. Maybe you have to go do an ICO template. That's okay, because this information will help you fill that out accurately and completely. Then we're going to do our own assessment. And some of the things that we're going to ask is, what data do we collect? Why do we collect it? Do we have data retention policies? That's something we don't really talk about. We collect everything because that's just what we've always done. Well, great, how long do you store it? Well, I don't know, forever? I mean, that's generally the answer I get. Doesn't mean it's okay. GDPR and a lot of the privacy laws say you can only keep data for the purpose in which it was intended, for the period of time in which it's required. So there's gonna be financial transactions under certain regulatory laws here in the US that do require you to keep that longer. And those financial things, you're not going to be able to delete. You'll tell the customer, sorry, that's financial stuff. We're required to keep that by law. And there are those outs. But there's a lot of other things that we're just not asking. And one thing that this takes into consideration is, what about AI? Does my organization use artificial intelligence in our data processing, in our decisioning, machine learning? Any other emerging technologies? Are we an emerging technology organization? I recently worked for a healthcare company, and they had medical device implants for their patients. So that's a whole different thing that we had to deal with emerging technologies and IoT. We don't think about those as an organization. We just typically think of historically, data's in a system, data's in a database, we don't know what we're doing with it. The business should know. The business goes, well, I just told them what it should do. The data scientists go, well, I just manage the database, and then you get all this finger pointing back and forth. So again, bring people to the table, bring your teams to the table, and talk about these things. And when you're going through your inventory and mapping, understand, what is that flow of data? Appropriate to collect the information that we're collecting. So privacy by design is also a requirement under the GDPR. And it was something created, a concept created by Ann Kavoukian in 2009. And it has 7 core principles of privacy by design. And if you've read the document that she's put together, they're just sentences. It's a 2-page PDF that says, here's the first one, here's what it means. Here's the second one, here's what it means. Transparency, things like that, openness. And again, I often get asked, well, what does that mean? How do I incorporate privacy by design into my SDLC? Now that I've assessed, I've done my inventory, I've assessed my problems, I know what I need to do to start developing solutions, and one of them is going back to my development team. They need help. They don't know what to do. They don't know all the privacy ins and outs. So that's where we as privacy professionals need to help our developers understand. What are the requirements? What can you do with this data? How do we incorporate end-to-end privacy in our development process? And so really, this is looking at things that we haven't looked at before when we're doing software development. What's the retention of the data? You're collecting data. It's going to go into a database. So up front, when you're doing business requirements, ask the business, how long do you need this? What's appropriate and necessary? And forever is not a good answer. So if anybody gives you that, you can just be like, okay, let's try this again. And really get down to the nuts and bolts of it. Third-party risk management. That's something we as an industry just are not talking about enough. Vendors are one of our biggest risks as organizations where we share data. And if you look at the Verizon data breach report, that's where a lot of the breaches are happening. But yet, as organizations, we don't really assess our vendors very thoroughly or completely. We just want to be able to offer that service to our customers, which requires us to sign this contract. So I don't care what their state is. I just need to help my customer. Okay, but let's make sure that they're secure, that they haven't been breached. Because if you're required to adhere to GDPR or California laws or any other global privacy laws, your third-party vendor should be too. So this is then looking at the software development process to say at the very beginning, when I'm gathering requirements, what's my obligations? Where's my data going? Data border transfers. Do I have consent to do what I'm gonna do with that data? So that's what this is really doing, is saying, here's all the things that we should be considering in software development and privacy by design that's really not built into those 7 principles, very detailed, that Ann Kavoukian created. So how many of you are a privacy engineer? Do you know what a privacy engineer is? So let me tell you. So I didn't know I was one of these until recently. I was at a NIST IAPP privacy workshop back in 2019, and I said, I keep hearing this term. I think this is me. So a privacy engineer is someone that knows both technology and privacy. So I started off as a developer, got into security, now I'm privacy. My whole background is tech. That's what privacy engineers are. So I highly recommend, if you don't have them on your team, or if you're a privacy person and don't have deep technical skills, that's okay. But wherever you can fine-tune those skills for technology, or find a privacy technologist, or privacy architect, privacy engineer, there's a lot of different definitions, that you have one to work with your development teams. Because they're gonna help say, yes, you can do this from a privacy perspective. And they're also gonna know how the technologies work. So when things sound not right, they can casually question that and say, you know, is that really right? Because it doesn't sound right to me. We all have heard about zero trust this week. You can't walk a booth on the vendor expo floor without seeing zero trust in almost all of them. But what we don't say is zero trust privacy. Oh, I can use Zero Trust to solve my privacy obligations? Yes, you can. And I actually met yesterday with Dr. Chase Cunningham and John Kinderbog, who created the founders of Zero Trust. And I said, you know, Zero Trust is a great concept. Restricting access, we need to do that. We need to change how we give access. But we can use the methodologies and the principles of Zero Trust to solve a lot of our privacy obligations. So look for this to come more. We're going to be doing some more research in this and get some publications out on Zero Trust privacy. And then monitor. Monitor your organization for changes. Monitor for changes in compliance landscape, organizational requirements, regulatory requirement changes, new regs that came out, reporting, audit, third party. Like, it's monitoring the entire organization for changes. It may mean go back and do a new assessment if you have a new application. It may mean changing and updating and refreshing in an assessment if you're making changes. One that's on here that's often forgotten is mergers and acquisitions. We don't always get to control that. But where you can get involved, do. Make sure that what your organization is acquiring or where you're merging, that the companies understand the threat landscape, the data that's coming into play. Because those rules and regs are not going to go away. They're just shifting. So to leave you with some final tips and tools, I'm not going to leave you empty-handed. There's lots of GRC tools. You've probably seen lots of them on the expo floor. There's memberships, IAPP, International Association of Privacy Professionals. ISACA does privacy now, has a privacy certification, and they're getting more into that. Subscriptions. I subscribe to all sorts of things. LinkedIn, that's the first thing I do every morning and the last thing I do at night. What's the trend? What's everybody talking about? What laws and regs have dropped? Follow different groups, especially if you're an international company. It's very easy to keep up on what's going on. Industry groups and training, things like this. So, in 1 week, identify your stakeholders. So you're like, great, what do I do with all this? It's hard, it's complicated. I'm not gonna tell you that it's not, but let's do baby steps. So in your first week, go back and ask, if you don't already know, do we have a privacy function? Who runs that? Who's responsible? What do they do? And do they look at systems and applications? Are they privacy legal and looking at more contracts? Because there is a difference. Some privacy teams are just legal contract lawyers, and they're like, I don't do that technical stuff. And I'm a tech person, and I'm like, I don't know the laws. So, but you have to have a balance of both. So figure out what your organization has. 3 months out, you can start to compare methodologies. So I've given you a lot today. Highly recommend you use the new methodology because I think it's simple. It incorporates all those other regulatory obligations into one unified methodology. But look at them and figure out what's best for your organization. Identify which one you're going to follow and then start to communicate that at about 6 months. So you've had time to figure out your landscape, evaluate what the best process is, slowly roll that out to the company, because people don't like change. Change is scary. But if we do this in baby steps, in small increments, it's okay. You can get there. And then at 12 months, conduct an assessment. Identify your inventory, identify your threat landscape, your systems, your applications. What risks did you identify that you're going to now have to develop solutions for and monitor? So with that, it's scary, but the biggest thing is just start somewhere. I'm not going to tell you that it's simple. It's not. I've been doing this for many years. Every day feels like a dumpster fire. Every day is challenging. There's always new laws and changes, and people don't like that. But it's okay, just start somewhere. So, questions? There's a few minutes for questions.
Thank you, Lisa, for a very enlightening talk about what we need to do and better assess our privacy. In many organizations, though, I see they assign the DPO protection officer role to an attorney who may or may not have a lot of data protection and cybersecurity experience. Maybe if you could provide some tips and tricks, how do we work with the non-technical people who now are responsible for privacy?
Yeah, that's a great question. So working with DPOs or others that don't have that deep technical knowledge, we all have a role in our organization. It's different. I'm not a lawyer. I'll be the first to say, I'm not a lawyer. I know a lot about laws, sometimes too much for my own good, but that's where it's helpful working with the legal. I've been reviewing contracts recently for our organization and just like, what are we doing for data retention? It's not in there with our vendors. What are we doing for data across borders? So what I've learned is that the legal team doesn't always know. They don't know those technical things. And depending on what they got in school or what their legal expertise is in, it's our job as security and privacy professionals to educate them. If you educate them on here's what data cross-border transfers is and how it applies to our company, now this is how it applies to our vendors, that gets you one step further in the right direction. And then you just built that person's knowledge up. Now they know more. So the next contract that comes through, they know how to review that for those security things. They can take that first glance at it and go, well, I know Lisa's gonna ask about this and it's not here, so I'll just, you know, I'll tackle it for her or erase that question. And that's what's been successful at our company as I continue to work with our legal team on contracts that don't have that deep privacy expertise. Great question, thank you.
Thanks, Lisa. Really enjoyed your talk. So typically we see IT has a very adversarial relationship with the privacy folks. And so how do you embed yourself into the earlier phases of architecture and design in an organization instead of what we traditionally see as retrofitting privacy afterwards?
Yeah, that's a great question. So going back to privacy by design, SDLC, if you embed privacy at the very beginning of the conversation, this is new to them. Again, change is scary. And oftentimes people think, well, how's my job going to be impacted by this change? But if you work with your teams to say, I'm here to help you, I'm here to support you, we want to make sure that we're protecting our customers' data, our employees' data, the best that we can. So let me help you. And let's start at the beginning. What data are we collecting? What are we doing with it? How's the system going to be architected? Where's data going? And being included in those initial conversations and building those relationships, once you do that and have that relationship, they're going to keep coming back. They're going to go, oh, this is private data. Lisa's a privacy person. Let me bring her into the conversation. I don't know all the answers, but I know she does. And if she doesn't, she'll find out, because she's privacy. And that's what we really need to do, is just make sure we have the right people in the room. They're not always going to have all the answers or answers that you like, but just getting the right teams in the room is what's helpful. And with that, I appreciate your time. Thank you. Be sure to connect with me on LinkedIn if you haven't already, and enjoy the rest of the conference.